Chapter number 9. John chapter number 9. Now last week we talked about the one who was lame, who was at the pool of Siloam. Jesus noticed him. He had no one else. But Jesus noticed him. I felt like when we were done the service last week, just from folks, them talking, sharing, felt like the Lord really moved and helped us last week in our service. Now I want Tuesday evenings to be that. I'm trying to think of a new subject to go on for a period of time. I'm just not there as of yet. So I am going to be trying to pull out some truths from things and send you home with some gold nuggets. Amen. From the Word of God. And I pray that that's what will happen. John chapter number 9. I'm not going to read all this or have you read it because it's very lengthy in its nature. And I think the best thing that we'll do, well, I said that, but let's... someone read verse number 1 through 11. That at least gets us where we want to be. And then there'll be some other things that we can share. Someone read John chapter number 9, verse 1 through 11. And Brother Eli, because of your question and just my reading in the Word of God, that is why I felt a tug at my heart to look at this tonight. Amen. You said, last week I believe it was, the question was, who sinned, he or his parents? You made reference to that last week, Brother Eli, reading on in the Word of God. Amen. This week, the Lord just kind of drop that in my heart. And I want to look at a few things tonight. Let's look at that situation where that statement, Brother Eli, you made last week is referenced in the Word of God. Verse number 1 through 11. Someone, if you'd read, please. It's okay. I can relate.
Sorry.
The arm's just not long enough today. Amen. So much information is given here. Why does God give us all these details of everything? Well, I certainly wouldn't be able to exhaust it. I could study this again and come out with some more things as I read and study, looking at different commentators of things that they have to tell us from this portion of Scripture. Now, when we look at miracles of Jesus, there's a four different translation of what describes miracles. The words that are used, one of the first words is dunamis, which is power. We know the word dynamite. Amen. Comes from that. It's a miracle of the power, the mighty working of God. Dunamis. Also the word ergon, which means act or labor. So he went forth, the word of God says here, and the works are the deeds, is ergon. God does works, he does deeds. And then there is simios, which is signs. There are signs or miracles. And so all these words being used. And then there is tyris, which is something extraordinary, or it's a wonder. Read the Word of God, you'll see all these words described to tell us about the acts of Jesus, his miracles. God is amazing. Amen. He has ruling over nature. He brings restoration of health. He has removal of demons. He has the raising of the dead. God is miraculous. Can I tell you something really crazy? So, I recently was talking with some of my other chaplain friends. And wouldn't it be something if we as chaplains walked in where someone was dead and we begin to pray and God gave them life? Amen. Do we believe that? Amen. I think all too often we can accept the facts of what's before us. Now, there are times we do have to do that. But where's our faith? I mean, God has power to raise from the dead. And so there's several reasons why God does miracles is because, particularly here, Jesus was being hunted down. You read the preceding chapter, he's being hunted down. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but he passed by. I'm glad that Jesus takes detours to minister to people's needs. But he took a detour from danger, really, because he was being hunted down. But part of the reason why he did this miracle is because he is a confirmation of the deity of who he is. He is Christ. He is the Son of God. And so he's doing that. And it is also showing that the demonstration of his divine power. He said that he and his Father were one, so it's glorification of God the Father. Is why miracles are happening. So showing also subjection of the power of Satan and evil to him, an alleviation of burdens in people's lives, educating people in spiritual matters. That's why God did miracles. So looking at this, the Word of God says, and Jesus passed by and he saw a man which was blind from his birth. Man, there's so much I want to say right here. But when I look, first of all, that in the USA, it is, statistics say, that someone goes blind every 20 minutes. Wow. And I'm glad I just have to wear glasses. I'm not so cute. I'm not for my eyesight. Here it is that this one is born blind. Now, I know that this is imagining. And sometimes I don't want to lose people in imagining, but I want you to think about something with me for a minute. This man, even though some people go blind every 20 minutes, this man was born blind. So he never saw the beauty of a sunrise ever. It's magnificent. You ever look out when the sun is rising, Brother Eli, that pink and red? But he never had the privilege of his eyes ever beholding that. He, Brother Craig, he never seen a sunset, but just never. I mean, we look and we see red in the morning, sailor's warning, red at night, sailor's delight. You know, we look at those beautiful things and we can behold them. And most often we probably take them for granted. He never seen mountains. He never seen what it was like for mountains to be crowned and snow. He never seen the wonders of animals or birds. I mean, we take it for granted, the squirrels we see running around outside or the birds that fly. He never seen a child smile. And in its purest way, he never ever seen the radiance of a beautiful woman. For a man, that's an amazing sight. But he never saw that. And so here it is. He never saw any of this. But Jesus, in his grace and his mercy, takes time to come and minister in this man's life. Amen. Now, there are several things. Let me just say, first of all, most commentators will say this is a picture of humanity that is born in sin. They are blind that they cannot see. And so here it is that God in His grace and His mercy, amen, He comes to this man. Now, one statistic said that there are 33 miracles that Jesus did. And these 33 miracles, at least that are recorded, that we see in touching the lives of individuals. Let me throw that in. There's much more miracles than that. But touching the lives of individuals and miraculously moving in their bodies, 33 that Jesus performed, 18 of them were requested by the people, but 15, Jesus took initiative. Did you ever think about that before? How many things has Christ taken initiative for in our life that we're not even aware of? Now, I know what it's like to petition Him and call Him, but how many times does He take initiative to moving in our life? Especially when we look at someone who is born blind. Our humanity, we are born blind spiritually. Amen. But the grace of God gives us blessings that we do not deserve because He initiates them. Thank God. He initiated salvation. We didn't do it. He initiated it. So thank God for the initiation of salvation. Here was this man. The Word of God says in Ephesians 4:18, the blind man certainly is a picture of us without Christ, having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the light of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart. We're blind without Christ. We need Him. So this man is a picture of the blindness of humanity. The Word of God says, David said, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. So here it is, this blind man is a picture of the destitute, the pathetic, the poor sinners that we are born into. Power of God that can change men's lives. I was reading, and one of the individuals I like to read his commentary was talking about how that in Colombia some missionaries went there and they were translating the Gospel of John. What we're reading right here tonight, they translated it. And as they were translating, it took them 5 years to get this translation done. And so as they were reading the translation, one of the chief leaders of the village there in Colombia, as they read this, in verse number 2, and his disciples asked him, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents? Jesus answered, neither hath this man sinned nor his parents, but that the work of God should be made manifest in him. All of a sudden, the leader stood up and said, stop! We have to change things. You see, I talked with a lady who's a missionary, and this is what she did. She rescued what I'm about to tell you. This leader of this Colombian village said we have to stop taking our babies that are born blind, our babies that are born with a cleft palate, our babies that are born with some type of impediment. We have to stop taking them out to the woods and leaving them to die. The Spirit of God convicted this leader in Colombia because he realized that God has a purpose and plan even in the deformities and the things in people's lives. Thank God for that. And you know what's interesting to me? The disciples who love Jesus Christ is asking, Jesus, what is it that this man is that? Is it him or is it his parents? What if you were to think about these Christians, what would you immediately think? Why, they should know better. What would they reference? What do you think they would reference? They had the Old Testament, right? What would be the biggest reference in the Old Testament that we see suffering? Is it because of sin? What's our number one reference in the Old Testament? The first book chronologically written. Job. Job is a picture. He didn't sin. But it was that God may be glorified. And here are these disciples that are following Jesus, and they're asserting and asking, Lord, who sinned? What's the link? What was the conduct? What was done? Was it his parents? Was it him? Jesus answered, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. See, Jesus didn't come to earth to condemn them, but he came to claim them in the fallen condition. And the Bible says that Jesus said, I must work the works of him who sent me. Something I believe that we can do without changing the Word of God, that I can be changed to we. We must work the works of him who sent me. We must continue doing the works of Christ. While it is day. We talk about this all the time. What does that mean, Brother Eli? While it's day? While we have the span of life. Because he said the night comes which no man can work. That means the end of the span of life is over. There's nothing yet to be done. It is written. Jesus said, I've got to work the works of him. He said, as long as I'm in the world, here in this span of my earthly ministry, I have got to work. Now, let me bounce back and say a few things. There's some assumption that was taught in that day and hour, and I found this very interesting. They felt that the sin of a parent could be passed on to a child. Some type of wicked lifestyle can cause handicaps. I know it can happen. I understand part of that. I've experienced children that because of their parents, particularly the mother, the consumption of alcohol, they are born with fetal alcohol syndrome. It's very sad. I've seen babies that are crack babies that are addicted to drugs, but they're done. I've seen things that the parents, but that is the teaching, that if a child was born with something wrong with them, the parent must have done something wrong. It must have been their sin. That's not true. How many of you have ever thought about this before? Sometimes God likes to take the way some children are born. There are some people that are born with handicaps. And man, they become the most powerful people because they learn to overcome because of that handicap. Not all handicaps is used as this terrible hold upon a life. Sometimes God says they can best be used by this handicap. Maybe some of us have them. But it was also thought that in a rabbinical work called the Song of Rebecca, the Jews believed that if a pregnant woman worshipped a pagan god, that her child would be born with a deformity. So they were probing, did this mother worship a pagan god? They also believed that a child could sin in the mother's womb. How ridiculous is that? But it was part of their belief system. They also believed in the pre-existence of souls, and they believed that all souls were created long before the earth was even formed, and they believed that maybe something happened before that soul entered the body. We know God breathes life at conception. Amen. We know that is when the soul is formed. One of the most amazing things to me as a parent, and you probably think about this, parents that are in here, that you don't just have a child that was formed by you and your spouse coming together, but God breathed a soul in them that will live forever. That is a phenomenal thought. God did that at conception. They also believe this. They also believe that some souls... They believed in reincarnation. So they believed that maybe some people weren't exactly perfect, but then they would get to that perfection as they were reincarnated. But Jesus answered and said, this man hath not sinned nor his parents, but that the work of God should be made manifest in him. I must work the works of him who sent me. The night cometh when no man worketh. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Listen, the healing of the blind man, amen, the reason for it was God desired to heal him. Amen. That's the whole reason why he was born blind. God knew that these people needed to see the deity of Christ, the authority of who he was, that he was God. And so although this man was blind, amen, God had a design and a purpose in it. Thank God that when we feel that we are not quite up to the mark, that when we realize our deficiency, sometimes they're there because God has created it that we may see him move in our life. Amen. That Christ may touch us. Wow. Thank God for the opportunity. The Chinese symbol for crisis is identical to the word opportunity. Now, I don't know too much about Chinese, just something that I read, but crisis is the same identical symbol for opportunity. And the Chinese say that crisis is an opportunity for riding the dangerous winds. Amen. I believe that when we find ourselves in a crisis or in a bad place, amen, it is an opportunity for God to move in. Right out the wind of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Thank God for that. And so the Bible says when he had thus spoken, he spat on the ground and made the clay of spittle, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man. And he said unto him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent. He went his way therefore and washed and came seeing. So Jesus, he spits on the ground and he makes mud out of the clay. And he puts it on the man's eyes. It's not the first time that Jesus has used spit. If you look at Mark 7:33, the Bible says that he put his fingers in his ears and he spit and touched his tongue. You see, there was something in these ancient days that people believed that the spit of distinguished people had the power to heal. Well, this may sound crazy, but that's really what they thought in those days, that they had a curative or a medicinal purpose. The spit did, particularly of these distinguished people. They believed that you could protect yourself against snake bites, epilepsy, leprosy, kinks in your neck, eye problems, if you took the spit of someone distinguished and put on your body. Now, you may say, wow, that sounds crazy, but let me ask you something. If you burn your finger, what do you do? Why do you do it? Is there something like internally that just says, that'll fix it? So before we cast stones at these Jewish people and the people of this culture, let's realize that maybe we have a little bit of that even in our culture, or even in our humanity. And so he spits. Wow. It's interesting what we read later, because I believe Jesus was saying something to the man more than what we even see. I am distinguished. I am God. I am Lord. The essence of who I am has authority over sickness and the ability to protect. How many times have we read this name? I have. And then he instructs himself, the man, to go to the pool of Siloam and wash his eyes. Why did Jesus do that? The pool that means sent. I'm not going to go all back into that, but looking at Hezekiah and King Sennacherib, and the concept of sending is important. Being sent and be obedient as we are sent. I think Jesus was even saying this: I was obedient to the Father as I was sent. You obedient, be obedient to me as I sent you. There was something about the man needing to be be obedient, Brother Eli, that he needed to go and wash. May I bring it back to us tonight and say, this whole scenario is also a type of us being born into sin, blind at birth, nothing that we can do over, nothing that we've done, nothing even that our mom and dad did, but because of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, we are born into sin, no one's fault. We need God to touch us, and he comes seeking us. We don't seek him, but he seeks us. There certainly is a longing in our soul, but had not Jesus come seeking to save that which was lost, we would still be lost in our sin. And so he seeks us. And then he comes by and says, I want you to see the authority that I have in healing your blinded eyes and protecting you and keeping you. Amen. And then he says, I want you to be sent. I want you to be washed. There's something important about the obedience of washing. Let me ask you this. Two ways I'm thinking in my mind. How are we washed?
By his blood.
Let me ask you this. How are we washed?
In keeping ourselves sanctified. By the blood, by the word of God.
And so we are sent. He opens, he does the work to open our eyes. But then he sends us to the washing of his word. That is what has authority. It's interesting because as we go on down a little bit later, we find the same thing in this case and scenario as we did as we looked at last week with the pool of Siloam. Remember what the religious leaders got upset about? He did it on the Sabbath. Case in point, once again, we'll see it a little bit later if we get there tonight. But here these religious leaders are so busy being religious that they miss an experience with God. Amen. Religion will not do anything for us. Someone's rules, someone's standards, someone's guidelines. Although the standards of God's Word, I'm not taking away from that. God's Word does have standards. But if we live by the standards of a religious sect or by religion in general, and we never wash ourselves in the Word of God and have an experience of Him touching our blinded eyes, we will remain blind spiritually. It takes an experience with Jesus Christ where He touches us with His authority and He sends us to the Word of God. And so the Bible says, down in verse number 8. Amen. He anointed his eyes with clay. I've already read that. And the Bible says in verse number 7. He went his way therefore and washed and came seeing. Amen. Thank God for the precious blood of Jesus Christ that washes from all sin and all stain and opens our eyes. Amen. When we take the blood of Jesus Christ, amen, He gives it through us. He says, be sent. Amen. Send yourself to the cleansing stream through the blood. As we wash ourselves, we can see. Thank God. Many folks, you know, you hear them say, man, the world's a brighter place. I got up and I can see. You know what? Our way of thinking, our morality now has changed because we see no longer through blinded eyes. Amen. But we see the beauty of all God's creation all around about us. Because we've been washed. The Bible says, the neighbors therefore, and they which before had seen him who was blind, said, is this not he who sat and begged? Those who personally knew him, Brother Craig, you said this tonight. Sometimes it's not all of our preaching, but it's the life that we live. And that is preaching. You want to talk about the real deal, Brother Doug? Our words can say a lot. But if our life don't line up with our words, it almost nullifies everything. But when they see those who once knew, they see the change. God, help them to see change. Help them to see change. They said, is this not he who sat and begged? Now, there's a couple things here, Brother Justin. There's a big change. This man won't beg again. That is what they're saying. Isn't it the God who begged? He's not begging. There'll be no need for him to beg anymore. He's not blind, Sister Tina. His life is changed. And they know this. Our life is changed. I mean, we don't do the things. You're not looking for those worldly pleasures. You're not looking for the satisfaction of sin. You're changed. Is that not he who begged? He's not saying. He's not begging. And the Word of God goes on now to say, some said, this is he. Others said, he is like him. But he said, I am he. Listen, he wants everybody to know who he is. When Christ makes a change, I want you to know who I am. I'm not who I used to be. I'm not a beggar. I'm not blinded. But Christ has changed me. He sought me. He found me. He took a detour from me. And he came by, and the authority of who he is touched me, and I was obedient to his word and went and was washed. Therefore they said unto him, how were your eyes opened? He answered and said, a man who is called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said unto me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. He's repeating almost exactly what Jesus told him to do. This man's called Jesus, and I went and washed, and I received my sight. This man that was born that had never seen anything now sees everything. Then said they unto him, where is he? Almost some sarcasm in their voice. Well, where is he? He said, I know not. And they said, they brought to the Pharisees him who was aforetime blind. And it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made clay and opened his eyes. Listen, on the Sabbath day, you couldn't even wear shoes that were heavy on your feet because they thought it was a burden. Brother Eli, you couldn't pull your hair and trim it. You couldn't cut your fingernails. I mean, literally, these are things that I've read that you couldn't do. Medicine was only to be given to people whose lives were in danger. You know what these people did? They treated their animals better than they treated people. They put so many stipulations on people, but they were better for their animals. If your ox is in the ditch, get out! Listen, does that not remind you of the world in which we live? There is so little value for humanity. Let's hug a tree. Let's watch our pollution. Let's, the animals, protesting, all kinds of crazy things, but they think nothing about aborting the baby. The demise of humanity. I think it goes to show us that when people are blinded and they live by a system of humanity, they don't even value humanity the way that God has designed it to be valued. The other night, they were too worried about being done on Sabbath. Then again, the Pharisees also asked him how he received his sight. He said unto them, he put clay on my eyes, and I washed and do see. You notice something he left out? He said clay. But he didn't say anything about that spit and that blood. It was almost like he was a little nervous to say about whose authority it was. When God touches us, we never need to fear the authority of who God is and what He does in our lives. Therefore, some of the Pharisees, they said, this man is not of God because he keeps not the Sabbath. Others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such miracles? The world loves to take away the deity of Christ. And there was a division among them, as obviously is there. And they said unto him who is blind again, what do you say of him who opened your eyes? He said, he's a prophet. Listen, he gave him the highest knowledge because that's the highest title he knew. But the Jews did not believe concerning him that he had been blind and he received his sight until they called the parents of him who had received his sight. And they asked them, saying, is this your son who was born blind? How does he see? What a stupid question. Really? That's a stupid question. They don't know. They just know Jesus has touched them. His parents answered them and said, we know that this is our son and that he was born blind. But by what means he now sees, we know not. So they only know by the experience that their son has told them. I'm going to stop here, but I want us to think about this for a few moments. His parents knew that he was blind. They knew. They had authority in knowing that this boy was born blind. Listen, if your child was born blind, do you think you'd have some struggles? I would. I would probably go through all the stages of grief. First of all, I probably want to deny it. It can't be. No. And then I'd probably be so mad that I'd want to spit nails. This isn't fair. This isn't how I want it to be. And all that's right. But as you process through all that, you come to a day where you realize, I can be as bad as I want. And I can be out of that. I can block the whole world out. But the facts are the facts. My son's blind. They probably did all that they could do to educate him. They probably did all that they could do to keep the house standard and the same. They probably weren't rearranging the furniture every other week. Mama probably didn't rearrange the living room. She probably kept it the same because it's best for my son. They probably protected him from others who maybe would mock or make fun. They knew all about it. They knew it. But one thing that they knew next is that he's no longer blind. This is my point. He's changed. I don't understand him. But I know by his experience that he is different. Our lives as believers should make others say he or she is different. And if they're not saved, they may say, I don't know how. I know what they were once like. But I know sins by the authority of God. So that's why I have to believe. There's much more that we could read. I think the parents even became apprehensive. You know, they were asking, do you know that these people could have been excommunicated? There were degrees of that. Some of it was by the temple. They couldn't go there. Some of it would be that they were excommunicated by people but allowed to live in their same place. And then there was a degree that they could be excommunicated, that they could be banished, and no one even cares if they drop off the face of the earth. And so mom and dad were probably concerned about this excommunication that they maybe, so they dropped it over in the son's lap. Son, you gotta ask my son. No one can tell our experience with God except us ourselves. Our families may be embarrassed or even ashamed, but the bottom line comes down to this, that no one can share the experience of the dunamis, the miracle, the work, amen, than us because God has done it in our life. So let's share. Does anyone have anything that they would like to say tonight regarding this passage of Scripture? Listen, it's our responsibility to share the Word of God.
I know the Bible says, though, about dating sin. But there's also two or three other, you know, where they said that the law came down until 18. And Jesus said, did they sin? He said, no. I think there's also two others, you know, too. I'm not sure.
Well, once again, when we look, and probably what we can reference here, but even for these disciples, they should have automatically referenced Job. Because they were taught by Jesus. They were taught by the Word of God. And to know that not all bad things happen because of sin. And I think if we're not careful in our life, we can point a finger at someone too. Say, well, maybe it's because of their sin. You know, I love how people are so uneducated. I hear of people being diagnosed with cirrhosis of the liver. Oh, they must have drank. That has nothing to do sometimes with cirrhosis of the liver. Yes, it can be. But there's a lot of other things. I use that as a scenario to say this. It's not sin. It's not punishment. I sat with someone recently who had a tragic loss. Were they living where they should have been with God? Probably not. But do I think that they did something terrible that this great of a catastrophe should have happened to them? No. And they kept saying, what have I done that God punished me this way? What have I done that God has punished me this way? I simply had to hold their hands and say, you've done nothing. Then why did God do this? I don't know. But I promise you, nothing that you've done, God hasn't been punished. Will we know it on the side of eternity? I don't know. But God has a plan on our life, even in the difficulties. Crisis breaks way to opportunity. Let's remember that in our lives. Someone else.
I think this has to be one of my favorite stories. I've had it for a long time. And two things stand out in this account. And I think the verse 3 says that the purpose is for the works of God should be manifest in him. And I've always thought back to creation. A lot of things God spoke into being. And I always thought that when Jesus spit that baby in clay, it was like he was making the eyes from him. But his work wasn't finished with that, because his other spirit was also taking that spiritual side as well. And when Jesus was on the cross and he said, it is finished, that he had completed the work of God, it was that rebirth of making man on the inside and again in the image of God. And I just love this picture of how he did that with this man.
Resources that can help us. I'm not saying we should read the Word of God, but There's nothing that duplicates the Word of God. But being able to get resources at times with folks who studied our cultures and custom, it's pretty amazing how it can really become so real to us. So I thank God for that. Amen. Let's stand this evening. Thank you for being here. Amen. I'm going to continue the next few weeks trying to find just some things that are nuggets that will touch your life. No, then wanted to get on more of a series. I appreciate you being here. Let's pray in prayer for all folks who join us on Tuesday evening. Believe that God wants to do great things in our midst. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Brother Justin, would you close us in prayer tonight?
Gracious Heavenly Father, we give you all praise and glory for everything you've done for us and shall continue to. Lord, we thank you for the word that you have me first and thank you, Lord, may you anoint our minds and our hearts to retain it, Lord, that we may take it with us and believe, Lord, to ingrain that which is rooted in our heart, that we can be transformed into your very image, even more. We ask you to give us the mercies of our time and our grace. Bring us back safely on Friday and Sunday when we have all these things to do.
Amen. His life is changed. They noticed. Our life is changed. I mean, we don't do the things. You're not looking for those worldly pleasures. You're not looking for the satisfaction of sin. You're changed. Is that not he who begged? He's not the same. He's not begging. And the Word of God goes on now to say, some said, this is he. Others said, he is like him. But he said, I am he. Listen, he wants everybody to know who he is. When Christ makes a change, I want you to know who I am. I'm not who I used to be. I'm not a beggar. I'm not blinded. But Christ has changed me. He sought me. He found me. He took a detour from me. And he came by, and the authority of who he is touched me, and I was obedient to his word and went and was washed. Therefore they said unto him, how were your eyes opened? He answered and said, a man who is called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said unto me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. He's repeating almost exactly what Jesus told him to do. This man's called Jesus, and I went and washed, and I received my sight. This man that was born that had never seen anything now sees everything. Then said they unto him, where is he? Almost some sarcasm in their voice. Well, where is he? He said, I know not. And they said, they brought to the Pharisees him who was aforetime blind. And it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made clay and opened his eyes. Listen, on the Sabbath day, you couldn't even wear shoes that were heavy on your feet because they felt it was a burden. Brother Eli, you couldn't pull your hair and trim it. You couldn't cut your fingernails. I mean, literally, these are things that I've read that you couldn't do. Medicine was only to be given to people whose lives were in danger. You know what these people did? They treated their animals better than they treated people. They put so many stipulations on people, but they were better for their animal. If your ox is in the ditch, get out! Listen. Does that not remind you of the world in which we live? There is so little value for humanity. Let's hug a tree. Let's watch our pollution. Let's, the animals, protesting, all kinds of crazy things, but they think nothing about aborting the baby. The demise of humanity. I think it goes to show us that when people are blinded and they live by a system of humanity, they don't even value humanity the way that God has designed it to be valued. The other night, they were too worried about being done on the Sabbath. Then again, the Pharisees also asked him how he received his sight. He said unto them, he put clay on my eyes, and I washed, and do see. You notice something he left out? He said clay. But he didn't say anything about that spit and that blood. It was almost like he was a little nervous to say about whose authority. When God touches us, we never need to fear the authority that God has and what he does in our lives. Therefore, some of the Pharisees, they said, this man is not of God because he keeps not the Sabbath. Others said, how can a man who is a sinner do such miracles? The world loves to take away the deity of Christ. And there was division among them, as obviously is there. And they said unto him who is blind again, what do you say of him who opened your eyes? He said he's a prophet. Listen, he gave him the highest knowledge because that's the highest title he knew. But the Jews did not believe concerning him that he had been blind and he received his sight until they called the parents of him who had received his sight. And they asked them, saying, is this your son who was born blind? How does he see? What a stupid question. Really? That's a stupid question. They don't know. They just know Jesus has touched them. His parents answered them and said, we know that this is our son and that he was born blind. But by what means he now sees, we know not. So they only know by the experience that their son has told them. I'm going to stop here, but I want us to think about this for a few moments. His parents knew that he was blind. They knew. They had authority in knowing that this boy was born blind. Listen, if your child was born blind, do you think you'd have some struggles? I would. I would probably go through all the stages of grief. First of all, I probably wouldn't deny it. It can't be. No. And then I'd probably be so mad that I'd want to spit nails. This isn't fair. This isn't how I want it to be. And all that's right. But as you process through all that, you come to a day where you realize, I can be as bad as I want, and I can be out of it. I can block the whole world out, but the facts are the facts. My son's blind. They probably did all that they could do to educate him. They probably did all that they could do to keep the house standard and the same. They probably weren't rearranging the furniture every other week. Mama probably didn't rearrange the living room. She probably kept it the same because it's best for my son. They probably protected him from others who maybe would mock or make fun. They knew all about it. They knew about it. But one thing that they knew next is that he's no longer gone. This is my boy. He's changed. I don't understand him. But I know by his experience that he is different. Our lives as believers should make others say he or she is different. And if they're not saved, they may say, I don't know how. I know what they were once like. But I know that they are changed. There's much more that we could read. I think the parents even became apprehensive. You know, they were asking, do you know that these people could have been excommunicated? There were degrees of that. Some of it was by the temple. They couldn't go there. Some of it would be that they were excommunicated by people but allowed to live in their same place. And then there was a degree that they could be excommunicated, that they could be banished, and no one even cares if they drop off the face of the earth. And so mom and dad were probably concerned about this excommunication that they maybe, so they dropped it over in the son's lap. Son, you gotta ask my son. No one can tell our experience with God except us ourselves. Our families may be embarrassed or even ashamed, but the bottom line comes down to this, that no one can share the experience of the dunamis, the miracle, the work, amen, than us, because God has done it in our life. So let's share. Does anyone have anything that they would like to say tonight regarding this passage of Scripture? Listen, it's our responsibility to share the word of God.
I know the Bible says about a pagan sin, but there's also two or three other, you know, where they said that the law came down and killed 18, and Jesus said, did they sin? He said, no. I think there's also two others, you know, too. I'm not sure.
Well, once again, when we look, and probably what we can reference here, but even for these disciples, they should have automatically referenced Job. Because they were taught by Jesus. They were taught by the Word of God. And to know that not all bad things happen because of sin. I think if we're not careful in our life, we can point a finger at someone too. You say, well, maybe it's because of their sin. You know, I love how people are so uneducated. I hear of people being diagnosed with cirrhosis of the liver. Oh, they must have drank. That has nothing to do sometimes with cirrhosis of the liver. Yes, it can be. But there's a lot of other things. How is that? I use that as a scenario to say this. It's not sin. It's not punishment. I sat with someone recently who had a tragic loss. Were they living where they should have been with God? Probably not. But do I think that they did something terrible that this great of a catastrophe should have happened to them? No. And they kept saying, what have I done that God punishing this way? What have I done that God has punished me this way? I simply had to hold their hands and say, you've done nothing. Then why did God do this? I don't know. But I promise you, nothing that you've done, God hasn't been punished. Will we know it on the side of eternity? I don't know. But God has a plan on our life, even to the difficulties. Crisis breaks way for opportunity. Let's remember that in our lives. Someone else. Story to me.
I think this has to be one of my favorite stories. It has been for a long time. And do they stand up in this account? And I think the person in verse 3 says that the purpose is for the works of God should be manifest in you. And I've always thought back to creation. A lot
works of God that he manifests in us.
Thank you, Jesus.
Someone else tonight. I don't know about you, but I find that there are deeper truths in God's Word sometimes than even what I read. I'm thankful for men and women who devoted a lot of time to studying, who we can pick up resources that can help us. I'm not saying we should read the Word of God, but there's nothing that duplicates the Word of God. Of being able to get resources at times of folks who studied our cultures and custom, it's pretty amazing how it can really become so real to us. So I thank God for that. Amen. Let's stand this evening. Thank you for being here. Amen. I'm going to continue the next few weeks trying to find just some things that are nuggets that will touch your life. I appreciate you being here. Let's pray for all the folks who join us on Tuesday evening. Believe that God wants to do great things in our midst. Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Brother Justin, would you close us in prayer?
Gracious Heavenly Father, we give you all praise and glory for everything you've done for us and shall continue to. Lord, we thank you for the work that you have been first and that Lord may anoint our minds and our hearts to retain it, Lord, that we may take it with us. Lord, thank you for the even greater than that which is rooted in our heart, that we can be transformed into your very image, even more. We ask you to give us the kind of mercies that we are trying to do our face this morning. Bring us back safely on Friday, Sunday, and we ask all these things to the Lord. Amen.